Well, first of all, I'd like to say thank you to Dr. Mayhew and Dr. Busness, especially for inviting me and allowing me to talk with you this morning about local outreach ministry. My task is a bit different than perhaps some of you expected. I do not have the honor this morning of preaching God's word to you in the proper sense of preaching a sermon. Perhaps the time will provide that in the future. But I have the privilege of presenting to you what Grace Community Church does to bring the gospel to our local community. And as I present this morning, I really have three goals. I want to dispel the popular myth that Grace Church and the Master Seminary, they just care about doctrine and theory and epexegetical complementary infinitives and not the practice of our faith. Many people know the reputation of our pastor and our president, our pastor and president, who is so devoted to rightly dividing the word of truth. And they see from his reputation and assume from his reputation that we must be all theory and no practice. Well, I want to dispel that myth this morning. Number two, I want to make you aware of opportunities for you men to serve at Grace Community Church. One of the things that current students and graduates always say is one of the best things about the Master Seminary in particular is that it is on the church campus. It is so closely connected with the local church. And one of the benefits of that, of course, is that you have an opportunity to put what you're learning in the classroom into practice in the context of actual, real, boots on the ground, local church ministry. And I want to make you aware of opportunities for you to do that, just that, this morning. And three, I want to give you some ideas about what local outreach ministry can look like so that when you move on here from TMS, when your time is done and you're in a pastoral role, you can have some template, some concept of how outreach ministry could work in your church. Now, of course, Grace Church is unique, and there are things that Grace Church can do that maybe not every single church can do, and vice versa. There are things that smaller churches can do that we can't do. But I hope that this at least serves as a template, as a sort of priming the pump for your thinking to be intentional about how you will lead your church and raise your congregation to be intentional about preaching the gospel to your community. And the theme of local outreach ministry at Grace Church is saved to proclaim. And if you would, open your Bibles with me to 1 Peter chapter 2. Apostle Peter writes in 1 Peter chapter 2 in verse 9, and of course the text is behind me as well. He says to the churches, "But you are a chosen race, a royal priesthood, a holy nation, a people for God's own possession, so that you may proclaim the excellencies of Him who has called you out of darkness into His marvelous light." John Piper, in his book, Don't Waste Your Life, explains that the wasted life is the life not lived for the purpose that it was given to live. The wasted seminary education is the seminary education, the time at TMS that's not spent for the purpose for which you're brought here. You're in class to learn the languages. You're in class to learn the theology. You're in class to learn how to preach and how to care for people. And if you came to Southern California and you decided, listen, this is a lot of study, this is a lot of pressure, I need some downtime. I'm gonna make sure that I watch the college football season through and through, you know, follow the Angels or the Dodgers all the way through the season, you know, I'm just gonna sit by the pool, relax, that kind of a thing, you're gonna waste your seminary education. Well, at least one reason why God has saved us, explicitly stated in this text, is so that we would proclaim His excellencies. And the life in Christ lived not paying attention and not lived for the purpose, at least partly, of proclaiming the excellencies of Christ is a life that is wasted. This is one of our purposes as Christians. See, God loves His glory. And so He saves a people who will display that glory by proclaiming to all creation how excellent He is. And Christians, true Christians, love that glory just as well. We actually esteem Christ to be excellent. And so we desire to proclaim His excellencies to all who will listen. And so our goal in local outreach is to equip our congregation to treasure Christ as excellent, to preach them full of Christ, and then mobilize them to effectively evangelize and proclaim those excellencies right where they're at. And we seek to do that in four areas of ministry. And because this is the Master Seminary, those four areas of ministry are alliterated. We have equipping ministries, evangelism ministries, empathy ministries, and ethnic ministries. And that's sort of an outline that I'll go through with you this morning. Equipping, evangelism, empathy, and ethnic. And each of them has a biblical foundation. That great text in Ephesians 4 that we're all so familiar with. Paul says that God, Christ, has ascended, led captivity captive, given gifts unto men, has given some as pastors and teachers for the equipping of the saints for the work of service. What we are to do in our task of preaching and teaching, pastoring and teaching, is to equip the saints to do the work of the ministry. And so equipping has a role in our outreach ministries. Now, we include baptism under that, and I'll explain why. Why would baptism be a part of outreach ministries? Up until recently, Grace Church has just made a recent distinction where we've transitioned baptism to the membership department because we've linked them philosophically. You are baptized, you become a member. But up until recently, baptism, we had that under outreach because baptism, thinking of it as the public identification with Christ and His church, right? That is the goal of all local outreach. It's not merely to have a great conversation with somebody on the street or hand a tract. It's to actually have a conversation that leads to repentance and faith, and not just repentance and faith and, okay, we'll go off and you can be a nomad Christian and be disconnected from the local church. No, but that connects you with the local church and brings you into a local body. And so baptism is there. Also, I would just exhort you, when you get your church and when somebody asks you for your opinion on this, ask them to and see to it that you require people to share their testimonies when they are getting baptized. It is a magnificent gospel opportunity. So not only does it remind your people that God is working among you, that there might have been situations where nope, you wouldn't have even thought that this was going on, but all the while, God's sovereignty is working and providentially working in the lives of these people through your church to bring people to faith. That's mightily encouraging. And then also because it does provide an excellent evangelistic opportunity for the unbelievers in front of you. So what do we do at Grace Church with that? Well, we have testimony counselors. We have to make sure that people don't decide that they're just going to wax eloquent and take up and they decide they want to preach that night. And so we just kind of get them. No, we give them prepare their testimony. And we make sure that it's a certain length and that kind of a thing. So we need people to serve to do that. And then we also have folks on Sunday nights that basically just help the baptism candidates, you know, calm their nerves. This is what's going to happen. Don't touch the microphone. You're in water. Here, let me help you dry off, that kind of a thing. So again, remember, as I go through these opportunities, I'm not only informing you because I want you to be able to use this ministry or these ideas in ministry when you get out there, but also because I am inviting you to serve us. So keep those two, that dual purpose in mind. How can I serve and how can I use this later on? Well, fundamentals of the faith is also part of our equipping ministries, and we put this in local outreach because I think that most people are the most people get saved at Grace Church through FOF. They come and they think they're Christians and they take this new believers class that covers the basic doctrines of Christianity and they discover somewhere through, man, I don't know that I really was saved. I don't know that I really was a Christian because if this is true, that's not my experience. And so we have that under local outreach. Classes usually last 20 to 25 weeks and they begin based on interest. So when we have 12 people sign up, we start a class. We usually do between 18 and 20 classes a year for FOF and have about 225 students per year. Last year we had 25 male teachers and 9 teaching assistants, and each of them take this FOF training course where they're composing doctrinal essays. They're getting trained, that kind of a thing. FOF has been translated into 20 languages and more, including Spanish, French, German, Portuguese, Amharic, the language of Ethiopia, Creole, Khmer, which is the language of Cambodia, and even Swahili. So, gives you a sense of the reach there. How you can get involved with FOF? You can take the class. Pastor John has said, you know, it's worth taking every 5 years. It's just a great grounding, cementing class that gives you an excellent foundation. You can teach the class. If you guys are interested in teaching opportunities, if you're interested in shepherding a group of young believers or people desiring to grow in their knowledge of the faith, you can take the FOF teacher training class and get involved in teaching that Bible study or that FOF class. Bible study came out because I was thinking of this. You can also lead an FOF Bible study. Many of you have the opportunity to serve in Bible studies. Maybe not all of you are the main teaching guy every 2 weeks or anything like that, but some of you are. But others of you are in that Bible study and can serve people in your study as a ministry of just to people in the church. And sometimes you see somebody who's less mature than you and you have a discipleship opportunity. Consider using FOF as a discipleship tool to take them through these core doctrines of the faith. And disciple someone. Same thing. Grace Evangelism is an 8-week interactive training course on evangelism. It equips believers to proclaim the gospel clearly, understandably, and faithfully. It's material that's been developed in our local outreach department over a number of local outreach pastors' tenures, so it's got a little bit of flavors from the past, the present, and I suppose going on into the future. We're actually in the process of adding some updates. It's available in the bookstore for you guys, and if you wanted a copy, I might be able to do something for you if you came and saw me. But we go over marks of a God-centered message, how to start and end gospel conversations, how to handle objections and respond to rejection, how to evangelize children, and how you move somebody from the evangelistic conversation and context into a context of discipleship. We have two classes going on right now on Sunday mornings at 8:30 and 10:30. They're over in the Grace Grill. It's probably packed. If any of you wanted to join there, you probably couldn't do that this year or this go-round, but I'd be happy to talk with you about it. I'll usually have 20 to 25 people per class, times two each year. We'd love to increase that if the interest was there, it's kind of how that goes. Love to see it grow as FOF has been. So if you're interested in taking that class or learning how to teach that class, I'd love to speak with you. We also have an outreach resource table. One of the most important things as you lead your people in being intentional about preaching the gospel is to make sure that you grease the doorway, that you give them every opportunity to go ahead and be obedient. You want to facilitate obedience at every turn in your church's life. And so part of that is getting them materials that can be helpful for outreach. You don't want to say somebody's interested in saying, I want to go and I want to preach the gospel on the street, or I want to go and just evangelize people all down on the corner every Friday night. I'm going to take a group of people with me. And the guy's qualified and you're like, all right, go ahead, be warmed and be filled. Well, it shows so much more support if you're able to say, that's excellent. Here, the church is going to come behind you and take these tracts, take these New Testaments, take these outreach Bibles that we can give you and provide them as best as your budget can do it. I would say that could be a priority in your outreach budget. But every Sunday on Grace Walk, Grace Church makes available some of these kinds of resources. We have CDs of evangelistic sermons preached by Pastor John, and some translated from Pastor John's messages into other languages, and then some are missionaries preaching the gospel in their churches and in their contexts in different languages, and we make those CDs available just for free. If you know somebody who speaks, one of them is Western Armenian. If you know somebody who speaks Punjabi, that's on there too. If you know someone who speaks Portuguese, you can go to this table, you can pick up a CD, and you can hand that to that person in the context of a gospel conversation that week. They're also available online. All of those sermons that are on those CDs are on the Grace Church website. If you go to gracechurch.org, you see a little button that says, what is the gospel? Click on that. You have a little gospel presentation, and then you have these 27 or so outreach evangelistic messages in other languages downloadable there. We provide tracts, Bibles, both in various languages, New Testaments as well. Books to equip for personal evangelism. Anybody at Grace Church, and maybe you don't want to say this, too loudly, but anybody at Grace, you should say it loudly. Anybody at Grace Church can come to the Grace Walk table and pick up a copy of The Gospel and Personal Evangelism by Mark Dever and Evangelism and the Sovereignty of God by J.I. Packer and for free. And that's designed to reflect our commitment to equipping our church. Now, if I see 150 seminary students who want two free books on Sunday, supplies might not last for you, but if you were interested in that and we're going to use those materials and put them to practice, that's what they're there for. So take advantage of that and tell your people as you minister at Grace Church and even other places, that there's an availability of that for you. And they're all free, like I said. Well, that's equipping. Evangelism ministries. This is the heart and soul of a local outreach ministry. It's actually getting out there and preaching, speaking the gospel to people. That great gospel promise in Romans 10:13 is that whoever will call on the name of the Lord will be saved. And then Paul goes on to ask, but how will they call on him in whom they have not believed? And how will they believe in him in whom they have not heard? And how will they hear without a preacher? And so that desire for God to have his glory from as many people as he is worthy of, that desire drives our desire to go out and proclaim that gospel by which they're saved. Start with Hope Bible Study. It sort of borders on equipping and evangelism. Hope Bible Study is a transitional ministry that ministers to those beset with life-dominating sins, drugs, alcohol, pornography, gambling, others, that people seem they're just trapped. They don't quite know how to put one foot in front of the other in their Christian life, or maybe they're not even saved. Sometimes that's a lot more likely. And we basically want to come alongside those people and show them the sufficiency of Scripture to put those deeds of the body to death. It's basically what you have is a 16-week interactive crash course on sanctification, where we're going through key texts of Scripture, on, especially the New Testament, on sanctification and explaining to these people, this is how we put to death the deeds of the body. This is how we mortify sin and we vivify righteousness. And so we're equipping them to battle sin through the sufficient Scriptures. We're preparing them also then, at the end of that 16 weeks, we want to prepare them to transition into the life of the body, the local church. That's where sustainable growth happens. I have those two passages from Hebrews up on the screen, you know, that encourage one another day after day so that none of you will be hardened by the deceitfulness of sin. And let us consider how to stimulate one another to love and good deeds, not forsaking our assembling together, but encouraging one another. This is what the church is for. And so we want to see these people in fellowship, under pastoral oversight, growing in a Bible study, putting into practice the principles that we taught them in those 16 weeks over the long haul. We don't want to just say, okay, this is how to do it, and then drop them off. We want to lifeline them right into the local church. You can get involved with Hope Bible Study. You can contact our leaders, Eric Dodson and Joe Dyvelbiss, at hopeGCC@gmail. Meets every Monday, 7 p.m. in the Tower Building. One of the ways that you can be involved in Hope Bible Study, gentlemen, is to ensure that none of you ever need to go there. And by that, I mean hold each other accountable. These things, these life-dominating sins, so to speak, don't happen all of a sudden. They happen by little compromises from here to here to here to here, and then it snowballs. And seminary students, as I'm sure you all know, are not immune to that. And so as you minister alongside your brothers, as you are in the classroom alongside your brothers, have the difficult conversations with each other. Hold each other accountable, making sure that there's no foothold for sin in your life. Nip it in the bud. You can also support, encourage, and disciple those who are enslaved. If you know somebody who's battling with life-dominating sins, help them. Tell them about this Hope Bible Study. Maybe even bring them along, ask to attend a few studies with them. Say, hey, you're in a tough spot. There's a place for you. There's a ministry for you to help equip you to get out of this rut that you're in. And come along with me. We wanna come alongside you and help. If you know somebody who's in that spot, we have guys who are equipped to help them out of that. And you can minister alongside Eric and Joe. If you're gifted in counseling, if you want to develop your skills as a biblical counselor, if you have a heart to help people actually put off sin and put on righteousness, please contact Eric or Joe about serving alongside them. They would love your help. There's so many opportunities for growth. There's so many people that are hurting and that don't want to say that they're hurting. And you know, this is Grace Church. This is where we're all supposed to be put together. This is the showroom. This is the exemplary church and all that kind of a thing. And so people who are laboring under the burden of temptation and repeated failure, they don't want to come and expose their sin. They're embarrassed, they're prideful, they're ashamed. But this is, if there were people, if they knew that there were people who were ready to come alongside them, ready to cry with them, ready to mourn with them, and ready to fight with them, to battle with them, I think that we could encourage more to come out. Prison ministries. Two of the largest jails in Southern California are relatively close to Grace Church. One is North County Correctional Facility up in Castaic, sometimes called Pitches Detention Center. And then also, and in that ministry, in that prison rather, we partner with Only Hope Prison Ministries. The chaplain who oversees multiple penitentiaries in Southern California is a member of Grace Church. And he does an excellent job with this ministry. We provide Fundamentals of the Faith studies and MacArthur Study Bibles to inmates. Get this, a couple years ago, and this is the same numbers are this year and last year. But a couple years ago, I think the highest was over 1,400 people in the county jail system completed the FOF class and received a free MacArthur Study Bible. 1,400 MacArthur Study Bibles in the jails in Southern California. Pray for that, because there it is. I mean, there you have guys who have access to the Word of God, who've done something to get that Bible. You know, they've gone through a 16-week class where they're answering questions and reading the Scriptures. Pray that God works through that, as He has been doing. Opportunities to preach in jail. You know, you guys come to seminary and you think, man, you know, I'm so used to serving in my church. I'm so used to being the guy who's asked to do all this ministry, and I come to seminary and I'm on the shelf for a little while I sort of incubate in classes and become equipped to do what I'm going to do while people get to know me and pastors get to shepherd me and see me. Well, if you want to preach right away, we've got a captive audience for you. Every single Sunday, there are preaching opportunities. Talk to me if you'd be interested in that. Men's Central, downtown Los Angeles, led by just an absolute gem, a guy named Lance Fessler, who's a part of Sojourners, so North County Correctional is for the county. Lance, this guy, goes into Murderer's Row down in Men's Central, and it's actually funny. They sit him in a room with 50 guys, and there aren't really too many attentive guards, but this guy, Lance, is just able to command the attention of these hardened criminals who, for whatever reason, decide they want to hear the Word of God preached, and he brings it. And would love to have some guys come along with him and preach to guys who really, some of them aren't getting out. County guys are getting out. County guys are waiting trial. These guys aren't getting out, some of them at least. Wonderful opportunities. We've also had the Urban Ministry Institute, TUMI, has partnered with us in the past and is still looking for our involvement to teach seminary classes in prison. You guys have heard likely of Angola, of out in Louisiana with Burl Cain and the revival that's happened in this prison, and the most violent prison in the country became the most, I forget what was the thing that they just started planting churches at different areas in the penitentiaries where the warden implemented a biblical program. Gobs of guys got saved, and a lot of them decided they wanted to spend their life sentence preaching the gospel to the prisoners who came in. I think 95% maybe were lifers, because they were all murderers and folks like that. And out of that has come, and you know, Pastor John was there, you know, even I think John Piper was there too, preaching at this sort of historic place. And we want to replicate that. We want to do everything we can in Southern California with the connections that we have and with the open doors that we've seen to do that. So TUMI has asked for seminary students who, in all their spare time, I understand, will come and teach seminary classes to inmates who want to be trained for pastoral ministry in jail, who aren't getting out and who want to be trained to do ministry in jail. Talk to me about that if you're interested in that. Rehab Ministries. So 45 minutes northeast of Grace Church, we go up to Acton Rehabilitation Center, which is basically your run-of-the-mill worldly 12-step program to, you know, rid you of drugs and alcohol addiction. A lot of times it's mandated by a court. A lot of times these guys are checking themselves in voluntarily. We go up there every single Sunday and do a men's worship service where we basically have time of scripture reading, prayer, and preaching, another preaching opportunity for you guys. On the first and third Sunday, the women go up. So if you know young ladies in your studies or your wives who don't have kids yet or can drop the kids off somewhere, interested in women's ministry in that kind of a setting, where you've got people, again, captive audience, again, people who are staying and who are hearing a load of unbiblical nonsense about, you know, higher powers and things like that, but a place who's willing to have sound Bible teaching come in, we would love to get you guys involved in that. We also have a Wednesday night men's Bible study, doing topical series on pressing needs for these men, again, trying to help them see the basics of the gospel, put one foot in front of the other. And we want to connect that to Hope Bible Study. We've been working on that to say, okay, you're up in Acton, you're coming out, you're going to get out, and you're going to live in the San Fernando Valley. Well, we would love you to come to Grace Church, and we would love to transition you through our Hope Bible Study to get you plugged in into the local church. Skid Row Ministries, one of the most heavy populations of homeless people, live 30 minutes from here. They set up tents, and you'll see it. Let me throw that. They set up tents like that all along the streets down at 7th and San Julian. And we bring teams each week or every other week to go and preach the gospel on the street, just walk around, try to engage folks, and have them engaged in evangelistic conversations. We were bringing food and water and clothes along with them to sort of just open up opportunities for engaging people in conversation. And after a while, some of the people there, some of the homeless folks there, told us that they preferred that that wasn't the case. They had so many other ministries there that they felt were just sort of out there to do their good deed for the week, you know, and they would give them these resources and then they'd leave. They wouldn't speak about the gospel. They wouldn't spend time with them. But they went to our guys and said, "We're really thankful that you're here every time, and you're talking with us, and you're preaching to us the things that, if they're true, are the most important." Like, they were getting it, you know. And so we decided, well, listen, if that's the case, if we can show our concern, maybe we don't need to do that tangible thing. Set ourselves apart from these other ministries that are just sort of physical suffering only, and focus on eternal suffering, and it seemed to yield good fruit. Also, so we go down there second and fourth Saturdays at 4:30, do that for an hour, and then at 5:30, we basically compel them to come in to the Union Rescue Mission. Union Rescue Mission is right there, and we have opportunity to serve dinner, and at the same time, while the men, we sort of men and women are separate, while the men are eating, we get to have evangelistic conversations with them as we sit and eat with them. And while the women are eating, we get to preach to the men, and the women get to speak with the women also. And so it's just opportunity to speak one-on-one, to engage people with the gospel even further. How you can get involved, join the teams. You know, every once in a while, this doesn't happen very often, but a volunteer will say, you know, this person is soft towards the gospel. I don't discern any reasonable threat. He wants to come to church, or she wants to come to church. We need folks to go out on a limb and go down there and scoop these people up and bring them to church on Sunday. That is not the kind of thing that we're used to doing, but I think it is the way of Christ. I think it is the way of reaching out to the least of these, and that would just be wonderful. And then you have to be willing to receive a different crowd. These are not people that you're used to seeing on Grace Church campus. We have a very sort of well-to-do, upper-middle-class aspect to our church, and we need to be willing and open to receiving a crowd that maybe we're not used to receiving. Neighborhood outreach. Okay, I have 10 more minutes. I will go quickly. Neighborhood outreach. Every Sunday, we have a group of maybe 15 to 25 people, faithful, faithful men and women who devote their time to preaching the gospel every single Sunday afternoon. Sometimes they'll grab lunch together. Sometimes they'll have a potluck up in J265. There'll be a little bit of teaching time and prayer, some teaching on some aspect of evangelism. And then from 2 to 4 o'clock, they are let loose. One place we go is to the North Hollywood Metro Station on Lancashire and Chandler, about 15 minutes away. It's just a huge transportation hub in Los Angeles, and it's a unique place. My wife and I went there, and it was just, I've never seen people more willing to speak about spiritual things and the gospel than at that place. I don't know if it's got like this force field of grace over it or something like that. But it's just amazing. I walked up, and in 5 minutes, I was talking to a 17-year-old kid who was kicked out of his house by his parents, just graduated high school, didn't know where he was going, and you know what I mean? And he's opening up about all this stuff to me as I preached the gospel to him. My wife had a lady come off the bus from Russia, and I mean literally like off the bus from Russia, and like hadn't been in America ever, hadn't heard the name Jesus. And my wife got to preach the gospel to somebody who just never heard the name of Jesus before. I mean, 15 minutes away. We would love for you guys to be involved in that. Door-to-door ministry. Take a look at this. This right here behind me is the green square is a half-mile sort of radius, approximate square, so it's not exactly a radius, but mostly. Yellow is a mile, and red is a half-mile. And in those, you can see sort of the definition in the houses, or maybe not all that much definition. There are over 13,000 houses inside that red, yellow, and green squares. And we basically are trying to do systematic, intentional evangelism through our community. See, we have them sort of sectioned off here. Take a look at section one, all right, over here in the middle. I'm glad the Katanis Beauty Salon got on the map. It was making sure to make its presence known. This is section one. This is section one broken down into 10 subsections. Now focus here on section nine down there. That's section nine blown up. And we have each house numbered with an artificial number and each house numbered with the address of that house. I mean, you basically say, this is the order we take our team through. And every single Sunday, we go through and we find out, okay, who did we visit? And then when we record on this sheet, address, what was their response? Were they happy to see us? What was their language? Did they speak a language other than English? And then we can get somebody from our church who speaks that language to follow up with them. What was their religious commitment? And we take out any pertinent information so that we know next week, okay, these people love that we were visiting them and they want us back. So we're going to go back to them next week. So we're being very intentional and systematic about going through our neighborhood, hoping to have as many volunteers as we can to go through that half mile, mile, and mile and a half radius, those 13,000 residences as fast as we can. In the last 9 months, we've knocked on 866 doors. Just over half of them have answered, which I think is a fairly good proportion for a Sunday afternoon. 312 people have been receptive to our visit. 312 of our neighbors are happy that we knocked on their door. 129 of those 866 have asked that we come back and speak with them again. 129 people want to hear the gospel again, want to have a visit from their local church again. I think that's wonderful. And a number have visited our church, and one man is actually reading through Romans. Roman Catholic guy came to our church after three follow-ups, decided to visit our church, and is now reading through Romans with our evangelism team leader. And just wonderful stories. I don't have time, but I'm going to tell you this story anyway. So they're reading through Romans, you know, and the Sheldon Coe, I don't know, is Sheldon around here? Yeah, Sheldon, was talking with him and asking, all right, Freddie, what's the thing you're taking away from Romans? This is a Roman Catholic guy, and he goes, that righteousness does not come through works, but by faith in Christ alone. That's his words, without prompting, without some sort of like five solas, you know, this is the way that the gospel is doing its work. And he's looked at this, he's looked at my buddy Sheldon in the eye and said, thank you so much for spending time, for coming with me. This is the goal of what we're trying to do. And then we go also train station, door-to-door, Panorama City Mall. We also do sports outreaches. We have a wonderful gym that we just renovated. And every Monday night, we have volleyball ministry and basketball ministry. We invite folks from the community to come play volleyball. And we have every week, you know, 20 unbelieving, mostly teenagers, mostly high school students who are really good at volleyball and like the idea of playing on a nice gym floor, who come and they know when they come that halftime, there's a 10-minute gospel presentation, and that there are going to be people who are asking them where they're at, and they know that they got to listen or they can't play. Same thing with basketball. I think anywhere between the lowest we've ever had is, I think, 15, and the highest we've ever had is somewhere over 50 people, unbelievers from the community who know, hey, I want to play on a nice court. You know, it's getting dark outside. The lights aren't coming on. These people are letting us do it, but again, they know gospel is going to be preached. That's what I need to do to play. Okay, going to go through these really quickly. It's important for me to say that a heart that has experienced the compassion of Christ desires to express that compassion to others. We care most about relieving eternal suffering, and that's why we do all the evangelism ministries that I just went through. But love dictates also that along with eternal suffering, or along with temporal suffering, we also care about eternal suffering. Along with eternal suffering, we also care about temporal suffering. Colossians 3:12 says, so as those who have been chosen of God, holy and beloved, what's the consequence of God's election, his sanctification of you, and his love set upon you? Put on a heart of compassion. We try to do that in a number of ways. We go to assisted living facilities where we just speak with older patients who need the companionship and are willing to hear the gospel. Do a little short message and some worship songs, prayer with them. It's a great ministry for your families. We support Children's Hunger Fund, food relief organization. This is something that you want to get involved in when you go into your churches, that work exclusively with local churches who have passed sort of a vetting process, so they know that they're not fake churches, that they're not unfaithful churches. And they have local churches at the front and center of food relief, so that provides a platform for the gospel. We support our local pregnancy centers and rescue missions close by. One thing that I wanted to sort of end with is, if you could turn with me to Isaiah chapter 49. In Isaiah 49, the people of God are given the privilege of eavesdropping on a conversation between the members of the Godhead. God the Father is commissioning God the Son to rescue wayward Israel, to bring back Jacob from his error and reconcile him to faithfulness. But as lofty as that divine mission of salvation for Israel is, the Father tells us in verse 6, Isaiah 49, 6, that it's not grandiose enough. He says, "It is too small a thing that you, Jesus, should be my servant to raise up the tribes of Jacob and to restore the preserved ones of Israel. Too small a thing. I will also make you a light to the nations, so that my salvation may reach to the ends of the earth." So as glorious of an accomplishment as it is, saving Israel alone is too small a job for a Savior like Christ. He deserves to be worshipped by all peoples, to be honored by all nations. God's salvation is too wonderful to be confined to any one nation on earth. It needs to reach to the ends of the earth. And so this is why we have a commitment to the Great Commission. And in Los Angeles, the nations have come to us. 60% of Van Nuys residents were born in another country. That's in the 99th percentile of all U.S. neighborhoods. A recent UCLA study said that 224 languages are spoken in Los Angeles County. So we have ethnic ministries. We have 6 local outreach, foreign language outreach Bible studies that seek to identify those communities and preach the gospel especially to them. We have Arabic, Filipino, Korean, Italian, Russian, and Thai, in addition to our thriving Spanish ministry, which meets in this building on Sunday mornings. And we're also working on a Mandarin study that's starting right around now. And if you speak any of those languages, or if you speak another language and think there's a need at Grace Church for one of these, I would love to speak with you, because we have a great stewardship entrusted to us in the metropolitan area that we are, that we're in. And so I would love to hear from you about that. Okay, as we close, I hope that you guys know that you can go to the gracechurch.org website, gracechurch.org/local, ministry descriptions for all of that. You can call our office. See me afterwards, please. I'll have a card for you. I'd love to speak with you. Go visit the outreach table. I'm usually there on Sunday mornings in between services. And if you haven't gotten one of these brochures, please do. This basically summarizes what I talk with you about throughout the through morning. They'll have them at the back if you didn't get them on the way in. And I hope, gentlemen, that was beneficial to you. I hope it wasn't just taking up time. I hope that it serves as a template for you as you consider how you will oversee intentional efforts to evangelize your communities when you become pastors in your own local churches. And I hope that a number of you have thought during this time that, hey, that ministry sounds interesting. I'd love to be involved in that. I'd like to hear more about that. If that's you, again, please see me after chapel. Love to get to know you. Love to get you involved. Let me just close with this exhortation. It's easy for us guys as seminary students to be so insulated from the unbelieving world. We have classes. We have mountains of homework. We have families to serve and raise. We have ministry to be involved in. We have Bible studies to attend. And the list goes on of our Christian interaction. We can get in the bubble for these three or four years. But I tell you, it's not going to be easier in pastoral ministry. You're going to be just as inundated with sermon prep, with counseling, with church admin, with raising your family and all the other responsibilities that you're going to find yourself insulated from non-Christians. You have a great opportunity now to, whether you serve with me or not, to discipline yourselves from the very start here in seminary to make the intentional proclamation of the gospel to the lost a vital part of your life. So again, whether it's with me or not, make sure you give yourself to doing the work of an evangelist, as Paul admonishes Timothy in 2 Timothy 4:5. You were saved to proclaim. You were saved to proclaim. You were called out of darkness to proclaim his excellencies. So may God get what he's worthy of from you and from me as we preach his gospel. Pray with me. Father, I do pray that this was helpful. I pray that you would equip these men to to preach the gospel faithfully. I pray that you would lay it on their heart to do so well and often and effectively, and help Grace Church come alongside them in training them there. Put it on their hearts to love your glory so much that we desire you to be worshiped and revered by all nations. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen.